All right, Sam.
Hi.
Let's do another video.
Sounds good.
So in the last two videos, we talked about panning and perception of sound at different volumes and same volumes. And we're kind of looking at chatting about stuff. You mean you're going to school, you're studying speech pathology, mm-hmm. and you're taking your...
neuroscience and audiology courses, so I'm kind of getting the, like, academia view of the perception of sound and how, like, we process things auditorily, and then obviously you have a lot of practical experience with similar but different but similar realms.
Yeah, and it's fascinating, and I get to, as you tell me stuff and ask questions, it helps me figure stuff out, and you're going to have to teach me all this stuff. I'm going to have to learn. Tell me what I'm doing wrong.
You're not doing anything wrong. A few of my professors have seen your videos, and they were all like, oh, this is all really cool. So you got
huge dad points.
Yeah. So you've got literal PhD people being like, oh, this is cool.
That's amazing. That's huge. That's great. Okay, so I've been putting a lot of thought into sound for a change.
Oh, huh.
I did a video about thinking outside the box, mm-hmm. as far as why stereo sound systems struggle to reproduce accurate sound, why stereos don't sound real, mm-hmm. in my opinion. And it has to do with the fact that sounds in the natural environment are separate energy sources, whether mm-hmm. it's a Marshall guitar rig or an acoustic guitar player, stand-up mm-hmm. bass or a trumpet. It's an energy source. There's sound energy radiating from this thing from a certain mm-hmm. unique physical point in space. And when we listen to that, if we walk into a room with a band rehearsing or an orchestra or just a bunch of people talking, all these sounds are coming from different directions and reflecting off.
And that's what our ears are going to be like tuned with just in everyday life, right? Because that's how the real world works.
And then with speakers, so sounds radiate energy, and it's energy sources radiate energy in lots of directions, and then we run them into speakers. We combine them, mm-hmm. which is an unnatural event, mm-hmm. which is fine. And then speakers try and radiate all the sound in one direction mm-hmm. and make exactly the same sound go exactly in one way. So you've taken these things that radiate all the kinds of weird sounds in all different directions mm-hmm. and then put them into something. We strive to make sure this speaker puts exactly the same sound. Mm-hmm. Kind of the parallel is imagine a field full of sprinklers, like a bunch of sprinklers over here. Mm-hmm. And there's a bunch of sprinklers over here. And some of them are going tick, 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 tick. And some of them go shh. And some of them go pff. Mm-hmm. And you're looking at that. Maybe you walk up to them. Maybe you walk through them. And then we want to recreate that sprinkler field for someone to experience later. Well, the way that a sound system, a stereo system, or Dolby Atmos or surround mm-hmm. sound does it, is they mount a bunch of shower heads on the wall. And they have all the energy coming from certain points. Yeah. Maybe they take all those sprinklers and they take one shower head on the wall and they try and put everything in that shower head. How mm-hmm. well is that going to recreate mm-hmm. these water droplets coming from all these directions by radiating all the water droplets from two directions or even from around? It's just you can't recreate a speaker sprinkler field with shower heads.
The sprinkler field's an interesting metaphor, but I get what you're saying.
Okay, so I kept kind of going down that path. And what I realized, sleeping, I like to sleep on this stuff, is we don't look everything that we see, not everything we see, the bulk of what we see, our main interest in things that we see is the reflection of light off of physical things.
Mm-hmm. Which then we get into the reflection of sound also, right?
We're concerned with not running into this when we're walking. So we're concerned about illuminating this with light mm-hmm. and the reflection. We spend our lives looking at the way that light reflects off of physical objects. We don't spend much of our time staring at the light itself. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Unless we're going out looking at Christmas lights, sitting around a campfire, or watching fireworks.
Yeah.
Or a rock show.
You know, those are very specific
things.
They were
looking at the actual energy sources. But mm-hmm. pretty much our life is spent looking at the reflection of energy off of physical items. Yeah. With sound, mm-hmm. the information with light is provided by the reflection. Yeah. The information with sound is provided by the energy source itself.
Yeah.
That's a completely different paradigm.
Mm-hmm.
It's the light isn't providing the information. The light is illuminating the objects that give us the information, whereas sound, a musical instrument, is providing the information directly.
Mm-hmm.
This is, sound and light, if we look at them from the same perspective, and we say the light is providing the information, like, for example, a computer monitor or a television.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a television or video screen, the light source, the energy source, is providing the information that we're interested in, and it's unified. And that's not too different than watching somebody play acoustic guitar or talking to somebody. We're interested in the energy source. We're focused on it. With the bulk of light, we're not. So I think that that was just one perspective I thought was helpful.
Yeah. Well, I think it ends up being really interesting, right? Because, you know, we think about frequencies across the range, and our eyes can pick up certain frequencies, that becomes light. Our ears can pick up certain frequencies, that becomes sound, et cetera, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's this very interesting, like, philosophical thing to engage in terms of how are these things the same because we're interacting with the same sources over differing body receptors, maybe, and how are they different? Because they end up being, you know, in terms of us focusing on the energy source of the guitar versus the reflection of the light. It's, does that make sense? Yeah.
And what if we were to listen to sound in the realm that we look at light?
Yeah.
Then basically we wouldn't be interested in the actual acoustic guitar, what someone's saying, we'd be interested in the way the acoustic guitar bounces around the room and the way the energy source reflects off of all of the surfaces in the room. And that would be our primary focus.
Yeah.
The actual energy source would not be of relevance.
And usually within sound world, you're trying very specifically to not play around with the reflections. We get padding and we get these sound.
We spend a lot of time eliminating that because it distracts us from
the
source.
And it's hard to,
And then that kind of brings us full circle to the beginning, is that speakers don't sound real-ish. Perhaps what if we are underestimating the importance of the sound reflections?
Of the environment.
Yeah, so with light, almost all we're concerned with is the way it reflects off the surfaces, and there's an energy source. With sound, there's an energy source, and we ignore the reflections.
And I wonder,
what if we raise the parameter? Now, there are processors that add artificial reflections, but that's kind of cheesy. It's the...
Well, and I wonder if there's this element, too, where if we're looking at two speaker sources and trying to make those two, or even 10, whatever, surround sound, whatever, make those sound natural, like everything is coming from a million different sources. And that is an impossible task, but creating the environment where there becomes these reflections that bounce off, well, now all of a sudden we have all of these reflections creating more sources. And maybe that's the thing that can make it more...
And I think we're seeing some of that, like with sound bars, where a sound bar has energy coming from here, energy coming from here, and then there's phase alignment to bounce energy off or create the illusion that's coming. So, I mean, they are trying to recreate these various sources or reflect things off of walls. And it was just something that I found. And the sprinkler versus shower head, maybe flashlight versus campfire, like a campfire. Is everybody gathered around an energy source, and everybody's got a different perspective on that energy source, and it sounds and feels and radiates heat differently to all the people around it. And now if we change that into speakers and the sound source, we would take a flashlight and try and recreate that energy source.
Mm-hmm.
And the like a home stereo or PA speaker shoots light or sound in one direction.
Yeah.
So trying to recreate the feeling of a campfire by using flashlights.
Mm-hmm.
And ignoring some of the aspects below, like we hear 20 to 20K.
Yeah.
Well, we see a certain range of light, but we feel the warmth of the campfire.
Yeah, so we're ignoring this completely other element in terms of, yeah, what we're feeling, because the flashlight's not going to give you that heat.
And ultraviolet light is above what we see, and heat is below what we see, mm-hmm. but we can feel those things. They affect our bodies. Yet sound, we relegate, okay, we only need 20 to 20K, but there's pops from that fireplace that we can feel and hear, or speakers, so not ignoring those to enhance the experience.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the last thing I wanted to mention is that I was thinking about it further. Is like almost all gatherings of people are people hovering around energy sources.
Hmm.
I was thinking about the campfire, and I was thinking about a rock show. I was thinking about everything that when a bunch of people get together, they're always. And then I was saying, well, shit, everything's that way.
Everything,
surfing,
yeah.
You're going looking for an energy source.
And the water
snowboarding,
is the energy
so now I realize that was just silly.
But I don't think it is, because like I think that it is in terms of everything is it is this everything because it's everything, right? Mm-hmm. But I think especially when we're thinking about sight, sound, sensation, all of these things, and breaking them up and apart into these specific sensations and forgetting that it is that just energy that goes along, that maybe our bodies have specifically evolved for specific reasons, right? Of picking up and adapting hearing, sight, feeling, all of these things. We have these specific sensation receptors to pick up that information. And it's like, we're breaking it apart, but what about putting, I don't know. I kind of lost myself there, but it's that we're breaking it up. And we can forget that it is all of that same baseline.
Oh, yeah. It's unified. Yeah. I mean, we're super sensitive to 20 to 20K, not very sensitive to anything until we get up to light. And then we're not, so we've got these two frequency ranges. But then we're also sensitive to physical motion, which is 0 hertz to 20 hertz. So we've got 0 hertz up to 20K. But then we can... You know, we did that 40K test where you and can kind of hair standing on the back of your neck. So we are able to hear inner
sense.
Yeah, I mean, the kind of the concept of at high enough level, all energy will be felt by us.
Perceptible, yeah. Or
energy can kill you.
Yes.
All energies can kill you. All energies can impact you. Physical energy, radio frequency. There's no energy that can't. Wipe us
mess
out.
Mess you up.
Yeah, in the right level.
And then also just thinking about all of the different like animals that have created these different sensory receptors, right?
Right.
Because thinking about animals in terms of their different sensory receptors, and we talk about whales, then they can hear these levels of frequencies or like these lower ones. And then it just kind of gets into, well, what is hearing versus these like different sensory things, like pulling these things apart, because I mean, what does that even sound like? It's like, well, it doesn't really matter because that's what their brains and their evolution has made useful for them.
Yeah, we're attentive to the things that are important.
Speech for our ears. That's why we've developed in these soundscapes that we have, is because that is the frequencies in which we can, our vocal cords can resonate, and our speech sounds, all of these things that we are able to do to create speech, those are the things that our ears have also evolved in.
That's interesting. Yeah, our hearing range is directly correlated to the sounds that
we can create.
Yeah.
Which, then there's that really fun fact about how cats have made their noises, I think, higher frequency when they became domesticated so that humans could hear them, because their normal noises are not noises that we can hear.
Higher or lower?
I think it's higher. Yeah, I think it's higher.
Wow, that's interesting.
It might be lower. They change their frequencies on one thing. The cats themselves, they can hear a different set of frequencies than we can hear.
But so they use our realm.
They've changed it to communicate with us, which is incredible.
The range that we can hear.
It's directly correlated. And so then that influences instruments, right? And the things that
we
make.
Yeah, we build them in the realm.
Because we're not going to make something that we can't hear to make music. Because music is something we can hear.
Yeah.
Or feel, maybe.
And then, So that leads us to, yeah, we could probably make things to extend that if we work on it. Mm-hmm. Or maybe we have the ability to hear things above and below. Hmm. We're just not used to paying attention to it. Like when we did that 40K test.
But then would we call it hearing still? That would be my question. Or is it something else?
You know, I think that my guess is that they can kind of measure brain waves and make sound and see what your ear's picking up.
Yeah.
And whatever your ears are like.
And I wonder if it's stimulating the cochlea, right? Because that's kind of the thing that we end up defining as hearing is, can it stimulate the cochlea? Mm-hmm. If it's resonating here and you can't hear it, then it's not stimulating the cochlea, which is going to send those neural signals. So maybe it's something else. Maybe it's stimulating the brain in a different way. I don't know. I'm not a neuroscientist.
I was thinking of the 40K video. I was at the swimming pool the other day, and trying to scrape off some algae from mm-hmm. the drain. Yeah. And in order to do it, I had to reach my hand in the water and dip my head in, and the pool pump was running. And when I put my forehead in, I didn't hear it. And as I went farther in, as soon as the top of my head went in, I could hear this, you could hear the water rushing. And you pull it out, and then up to my forehead, I couldn't hear it. So you know how we, in the back of my brain, on the back of our heads, right at that bone there, we've got sensitivity, but there's another one right on the top that is sensitive. And it's really easy to check out that by dipping different parts of your head into water, ocean, that's and making noise.
And then that's like the bone conduction, right?
Bone conduction thing. But is that hearing? Or is it something we just sense because it's not coming in my ears? Or maybe it is.
Because then you have bone conduction and mm-hmm. bone-anchored hearing aids, and you have all of these things. And it is sending those sound waves that it's picking up through the bone and stimulating the cochlea. So it is still hearing.
Ah, very cool.
So it could be that this resonates at a certain way. It is stimulating the cochlea, and then it's hearing, but it's because your skull is vibrating or something like that.
But when we did the test with 40K, we felt it. We didn't hear it. And it's above what our cochlea mm-hmm. can perceive. Mm-hmm. Is that hearing? Or was it just resonating and recreating a lower frequency we could feel? But I didn't really hear it. I just felt a cringe.
But maybe it's not stimulating the cochlea. Maybe it's just messing with our brain in certain ways.
Yeah,
our brain. And maybe that's not hearing.
All right, Sam, thank you. And energy sources versus energy reflections, how we live our lives.
I think
listening to energy sources and viewing energy reflections as our primary focus, and secondary to hearing is the energy reflections, and mm-hmm. secondary to seeing is looking at these energy sources. So they're flipped over.
Yeah, yeah. It's an interesting thing to think about.
Cool.
Thanks, Dad.
All right, Sam. Great to see you.
You as well.